So we are considering now the application-oriented questions as far as this chapter is concerned. Let's consider the first one. It says, a vibrating tuning fork is placed over the mouth of a burette. A vibrating tuning fork is placed at the mouth of a burette filled with water. The tap is opened and the water level gradually falls. When the tap is opened, we see that the water level gradually falls. It is observed that the sound becomes loudest at a particular length of air column. I explained this experiment also when we studied resonance in air column. There is a burette that is filled with water, a normal burette which we use during titration. It is filled with water. We are opening the tap. Once we open the tap, the water level gradually starts falling. At a particular length of air column, I will see that a loud sound is heard. They are asking you to name the phenomena. What would be the answer for this? The phenomena that occurs is resonance in air column. Be specific. Don't just say resonance, because it is resonance in air column. Second question, when does the sound become the loudest? The sound becomes loudest when the length of air column corresponds to the frequency of vibrating body. So the frequency of the air column equals the frequency of vibrating body. We say that loudest sound is heard. Next question, name the phenomena occurring when the sound produced is not the loudest. When the sound produced is not the loudest, definitely we say it is nothing but forced vibration. Why? Resonance is a special case of forced vibration, wherein we have maximum amplitude and loudest sound. So when maximum amplitude and loudest sound is not there, which other phenomena would occur? Simply forced vibration. How about the next one? What change, if any, would you expect in the characteristic of musical sound when we increase the frequency? So if I increase the frequency, what is the change I will notice? And when I increase its amplitude, what is the change I will notice? The change in characteristic of musical sound that I would see when the frequency increases is that the pitch of sound also increases. Because frequency and pitch are directly proportional to one another. So when frequency increases, pitch also increases. As far as amplitude is concerned, we know loudness is directly proportional to amplitude square. So when amplitude increases, definitely loudness automatically increases. How about this one? Sound made in front of a tall building. Sound made in front of a tall building is 18 meters away and is repeated. Is 18 meters away and is repeated. They are asking you to name the phenomena and explain it briefly. So what is the phenomena that occurs when the sound is repeated after covering a minimum distance of 18 meters? The answer is obvious. The phenomena is known as echo. And then they are also asking you to explain the echo. So echo is nothing but the reflection of sound that is heard after sound wave strikes a solid rigid obstacle placed at a minimum distance of 17 meters such that the sound persists in our ear for 0.1 second. How about this one? A tuning fork is held over an air column of a given length and produces a distinct audible sound. What will you call this phenomena? A distinct audible sound. That means it's a clear, loud sound. So what should be the name of the phenomena? Yes, resonance in air column. And how does it occur? It occurs because the length of air column has a frequency equal to or an integral multiple of frequency of the vibrating tuning fork. As a result, resonance has occurred. Let's consider another question that is based on sonar. Well, as we were discussing during the applications also, that sonar is nothing but an application of echo, which is used in determining the depth of sea. They are asking you a question, what does sonar stand for? Or what is the full form of sonar? Well, the full form of sonar is SO stands for sound, NA stands for navigation, and R stands for ranging. So we abbreviate this sonar as sound, navigation, ranging. It is based on the principle of echo, that is the reflection of sound. How about this question? State two ways by which the frequency of transverse vibration in case of a straight string can be decreased. We had studied the law of vibrating strings. While studying law of vibrating strings, we did study three factors on which the frequency depends. One was the length, second was the tension, and third was the linear density. The two ways of decreasing the frequency of straight strings are, first one, by increasing the length of the string, because frequency is inversely proportional to the length of the string. Second one, by decreasing the tension in the string. So if I release the string or if I apply less tension in the string, definitely the frequency of vibration is going to decrease, because we know the relation, frequency is directly proportional to square root of tension. How about this one? Explain why musical instruments like guitar are provided with hollow boxes. I did explain you this part also. It is something like this. When I stretch the string or if I pluck the string, which is there in a guitar, what is happening? It is setting the air that is surrounding it into vibration. This air is transferred to the air that is present in the hollow box. So it is setting that air into vibration. That means it is forcing its vibration on the air molecules that are present in the hollow box. So when I set or pluck a string into vibration, I set the air column that is there in the hollow box into vibration. Those are forced vibration. But then again, I know that if I design the hollow box in such a way that I can have a louder sound that is produced or the highest peak sound that can be produced, I see that the phenomena of resonance occurs. So therefore, we have the answer over here. Musical instruments like guitar are provided with hollow boxes because since strings are set into vibrations, the forced vibrations are produced in the box. Second point, since box has a larger area, it sets large volume of air into vibration, which produces a loud sound having the same frequency as that of the string. Talking about another one, they are asking you, when a tuning fork is struck against a rubber pad, when the tuning fork is struck against a rubber pad and held across a length of air column in a tube, it produces a loud sound. They are asking you to name the phenomena. Again, a repeat question wherein it says it is resonance in air column. They are asking you to define the unit of loudness also. What is the unit of loudness? Loudness is not a measurable quantity. It's a comparable quantity. However, when we quantify loudness, we get intensity. And the unit of intensity is nothing but microwatt per meter square. Let's consider another question. It's a very common question which of course have to occur in a person's mind. We see sometimes when a vehicle is driven at a particular speed, say for example you have a motorcycle or you have the car that is driven at a particular speed, a rattling sound is heard. Have you ever noticed this particular phenomena? Explain briefly why such a phenomena occurs and give the name to the phenomena that takes place. They are also asking you to suggest one way by which the rattling sound could be minimized or stopped. Now what is happening? The car is made to move with a particular speed. A particular speed so high enough that the body parts start rattling. You know how the car operates? There is a piston that drives the engine. So the frequency of the vibrations of the piston in case of a car or in case of a motorcycle also is going to give you the frequency of vibration. So this frequency of vibration, when it matches or is an integral multiple of the frequency of the car part or the automobile part, we see that the phenomena of resonance occurs. Now this phenomena of resonance definitely occurs as a result of rattling sound that has been heard. How can we minimize this? The minimization can take place by reducing the speed of the motorbike or automobile. The moment we reduce the speed, frequency changes, frequency reduces, as a result, the rattling sound stops. Next one, we go ahead with the solved numericals. This is a chapter that is having a large coverage as far as numericals are concerned, mostly on echo. The first part, that is V is equal to F lambda, has been covered in your 9. So here we are just going to have numericals that are based on echo. Let's consider the first one. It's a general one which is covering your 9th standard. So just one example that is put across over here which will cover your V is equal to F lambda. A wave is shown in the diagram. A wave is shown in the diagram, travels from A to B. 120 meters in 3 seconds. So the distance it is traveling in 3 seconds is given as 120 meter. You're asked to calculate the velocity, the wavelength, the frequency and the time period. Well, as far as wave velocity is concerned, we have the formula. Wave velocity is equal to distance travelled upon time taken. We are given the distance 120 meter. We are given the time 3 seconds. So we have the wave velocity as 120 divided by 3, that is 40 meter per second. Looking at the figure again, we see that it's almost 1.5 wave that has been traveled. So the distance that they have given of 120 meter is 1.5 wave. And what is the distance traveled by one wave called? Wavelength. So 1.5 lambda is equal to 120. So therefore, if we just calculate the value of lambda, we get lambda is equal to 120 multiplied by 2 by 3 which is equal to 80 meter. So I get the wavelength as 80 meter. I know the wavelength. I know the wave velocity. I use the relation wave velocity is equal to frequency into wavelength. Using that relation wave velocity equal to frequency into wavelength, I get 40 is equal to frequency multiplied by 80. If I substitute, I get the frequency as 40 upon 80, that is 0.5 hertz. Remember, one should be very careful as far as the units are concerned. Now that we know the wave velocity, now that we know the wavelength, now that we know the frequency, we can very easily find the time period. Why? Because time period is nothing but 1 upon frequency. The reciprocal of frequency is time period. So if I calculate the time period by using the formula 1 upon frequency, I get time period is equal to 1 upon 0.5. That is nothing but 2 seconds. So this was just a recap for the 9th standard. However, as I said, in 10th, you have numericals on echo. So taking this one, a boy hears an echo of his own voice from a distant hill after 1 second. The boy is standing in front of a hill. It's far off. That means the distance is more than 17 meters. And he's shouting over there. He hears the echo after 1 second. The speed of sound in air is given as 350 meter per second, 350 ms minus 1. What is the distance of the hill from the boy? We are asked to calculate the distance of the boy from the hill. How do we do it? Our first statement in this case will be, let the distance of the boy from the hill be x meter. That is our assumption. We know the formula for wave velocity equal to twice distance upon time for an echo to occur. So we say for an echo to occur, wave velocity is equal to twice distance upon time. I substitute the value 350 is equal to twice x upon time. Time they have given us 1 second. Then I substitute the values over there to get the distance of the hill from the boy as 350 divided by 2. That is 175 meter. It's a very simple question. But then you have to have a systematic approach to a numerical. How about this one? An observer is situated between two parallel cliffs. So there are two cliffs. He's basically surrounded by the cliffs. He's between the two cliffs. He's emitting an intense sound note. Two successive echoes will be heard. Why two successive echoes will be heard? One after striking one cliff and second after striking the second cliff. Two successive echoes are heard after 5 seconds and 7 seconds. So they have given you the time for which the echo is occurring in both the cases. Calculate the distance between the cliff. You are asked to calculate the distance between the cliff given velocity of sound as 340 meter per second. Well, let's see how we are going to solve this particular sum. We have two parallel cliffs and the person situated between it. The time taken for the first echo is 5 seconds. The time taken for the second echo is 7 seconds. Let's presume that the distance between the first cliff and the observer is x meter. The distance between the second cliff and the observer is y meter. So for the first case, I say wave velocity is equal to twice distance upon time. So I have 340 is equal to 2 times x divided by 5. As a result, I get x is equal to 850 meter. So I get the value of x, that is the distance of the observer from the first cliff, as 850 meter. How about the second cliff now? Well, we are applying the same phenomena for the second cliff, but the time here that we are going to take is 7 seconds. So for the second echo to occur, wave velocity is equal to twice distance upon time. The formula is unique. So wave velocity is equal to 2y upon t. Wave velocity we know as 340 is equal to 2y upon 7. Solving for y, I get the value of y as 1180 meter. Now, the person is situated between the two. So if I have to calculate the total distance, it is definitely going to be this distance x plus the distance y. If I add both together, I get 850 plus 1180, which is nothing but 2040 meter. So I know that the distance between the two parallel cliffs is 2040. Again, similar type. A boy stands 66.4 meter, or let's say it as 66.2 meter, in front of a high wall. A boy is standing at a distance of 66.2 meters in front of a high wall and blows a whistle. He literally blows a whistle standing in front of a hill. Calculate the time interval. You're asked to calculate the time interval when he hears an echo. You're given the velocity of sound as 332 meter per second. You're given the distance 66.2 meter. You're given the velocity 332 ms minus 1. Which is the equation you're going to use for an echo to occur? Wave velocity is equal to twice distance upon time. So if I substitute, I get time taken is nothing but total distance upon the velocity of sound. I'm asked to calculate the time. So I'm taking time as the subject of the formula. So when I substitute, I get time taken as 132.4 divided by 332, which is nothing but 0.45 second. How did I get that 132.4? It is nothing but twice 66.2. So it is 0.45 second. That means the time required for the echo to be heard was 0.45 second. How about this one? This is about a ship now. A ship which is stationary at a distance of 680 meter. It's stationary. It's anchored at a particular place. 680 meter from the shore sends a signal to the coast. So there's something at the coast and the signal is sent across to the coast. An echo is heard back in 4 seconds. So the sound reaches the obstacle and comes back in 4 seconds. You're asked to find out the velocity of sound. You're given the distance at which the ship is anchored. You're given the time that is taken for the sound to go and return back. They're asking you to find out the velocity of sound. We use the relation wave velocity is nothing but distance upon time, total distance taken upon time taken. So we have velocity of sound as total distance traveled upon the time taken, that is 1360 divided by 4, which is nothing but 340 meter per second. 340 340 meters per second is nothing but the velocity of sound which they have asked you to determine.